So I'm here with my friend Zach, who's the owner of Mushroom Cult. So want to tell us a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, I'm interested in mycology, and I love sharing information about mushroom cultivation and learning along with you guys. We kind of paired up and did some classes throughout the summer, or I guess over the winter, and it's been really great to meet some of you guys and to learn from each other. And it was kind of interesting because I didn't know that I enjoyed helping other people learn about mycology until I started doing the classes, and it blew my mind how much fun it is.
Awesome. So since all of this started happening recently, I've been breeding some new strains. So I just wanted to do a shout out. I've got some new liquid cultures. If you check out our Etsy, we got some brown beach mushrooms. And you can see I've been doing a lot of top fruiting lately. So these brown beach are now available on Etsy.
But as a liquid culture?
Yep, liquid culture. So we've got these nice liquid cultures on Etsy. And we also got these lion's mane capsules there, free shipping. So if anyone has any questions, feel free to ask away. All right, so topics of discussion. So one thing that has been going around recently, since the weather is getting nicer and a lot of wild mushrooms are starting to pop, it's a good time to start cloning new strains. And one method that is starting to become more popular is the water auger. So I know that Zach has a little bit more experience with that. What do you know about water auger?
It's kind of an interesting tool. So auger is mostly water no matter what recipe you use, but water auger would just basically mean that you're not adding any additional nutrients, so all you have is water and a gelling agent. So what that does is that it kind of is a selective media, so organisms that need a lot of nutrition are not going to grow very quickly, or maybe not at all, on the water auger. And so if you're cloning, you're taking a small piece of mycelium and placing it in the petri dish, and there's a little bit of reserve energy there, and so the mycelium can jump across the water auger, and you're able to isolate it from some of the contaminants that might be around the initial sample by selecting from the leading edge. It's pretty interesting. I don't think it'll work every single time, but it's definitely a fun tool to play with.
Very cool. So in the past, I've used antibiotics with my auger to try and mitigate bacteria, but I feel like water auger is going to become more of a staple with, yeah, you know, how cheap it is, and it doesn't release antibiotics into the environment, which could potentially make antibiotic-resistant bacteria. So I feel like it's a nice alternative.
Yeah, it's definitely a tool that you should play with and see how it works for you. You can definitely fail with it. It's not foolproof, but it's worth trying.
Cool. All right. So any other topics you want to cover?
Yeah, so as far as foraging goes, did want to just an update, if you weren't aware of it, that oysters are out right now. So you can find Pleurotus pulmonarius on stumps, like maybe you could look for cottonwoods or willows or maybe elm trees in your area. That's a pretty easy one to identify if you just look up a picture. Here's an example of an oyster. This one's a little more delicate than you might find in the wild. In the wild, they'd be thicker, probably shorter, unless you're really lucky. So you can see that the gills kind of run down the stem. There's a darker color on the surface. Sometimes there's a curl. Usually the cap unfurls this way. This is kind of an interesting how it's curling back. They usually make a shelf. So oysters are pretty easy to identify. There's very few that you're gonna confuse it with, especially in this season. So that's something to go look for. You should definitely not eat mushrooms unless you know for sure what they are. And a great way to find out is to post a picture with the location of where you found it, the mushroom, the top and the bottom, maybe a picture of, sometimes you can find spores on a nearby leaf or on top of the cap, and a general location of where it is, like what state you're in or country. And you can post it on Facebook mushroom identification groups, and there's people who are just sitting at their computer waiting for someone to post a picture to identify it for you. So you can have a pretty good confidence of what you're finding by submitting it to an expert, but don't eat it if you don't know what it is. So there's oysters, that's out right now. There's mica caps, Coprinus micaceus. Those might be marginally edible. And some of them have reactions with alcohol if you're picking the wrong species that you might not want to be drinking before or after.
What about pheasant backs? Are those out?
They're not going to be fresh right now, but I've been finding them. I found one today, and you can see the dead. They'll look similar to an oyster. They have a shelf, but on the bottom they have octagonal or kind of round pore surfaces rather than having the gills. Like these would be called gills. And so if these were like in octagonal shapes, you might have a pheasant back. And I've never eaten one. I'm looking for them this year, but I hear that when they're young, they're pretty good to eat. I did a video recently that I posted on Facebook where I found a dried one. And so the important thing about finding a dry one is that that's where you want to look later in the season when it's warm, maybe after a rain, that you might find it popping out fresh. So you can find those now. Let's see, what else? Yeah, I guess another thing to be mindful of is that poison ivy in this season, it's not going to have leaves on it. So it's going to look like just trees suckering up from the ground. It looks a lot like scrub oak at this point. You might find white berries, little white berries. I just posted a video about that as well, if you're unaware of what poison ivy looks like. So you might be out looking for morels or oysters, and you might be surrounded by poison ivy. So you just want to be aware that we do have that in all the river basins. Like, it's in Castle Rock in dry areas, it's along the Platte, it's in all the river valleys that go up to the mountains. So if you're in Denver, be aware of that.
I think it's always good to be aware of ticks too. Make sure you wear like long pants, especially if you're gonna be romping around in the tall grass. So just some things to consider.
Yeah. And yeah, I'll be posting more videos as I find mushrooms. I'm bringing a camera with me, and I'll take video of the location that it's found and the harvesting, and maybe even of the process of cloning. Which, that also reminds me, if you're in the Denver area and you find a mushroom, I would love a small sample, even if it's the stem butt that's all dirty that you wouldn't eat anyway. What I would like to do is collect genetics from as many different mushrooms in the area as possible and clone those. And if it's a mushroom that I'm able to clone onto a petri dish, and I'll move it on to grain and sawdust, if I'm able to get through that process, I'll give you a spawn bag back in exchange for a small sample of the fresh mushroom and, you know, just a general location. I don't need to know the exact spot of where your favorite mushrooms are, but I would like to know general part of town so that I can identify it and separate it from everyone else.
Cool. So you heard it here. Mushroom bank starting with mushroom cult.
Yes.
Send them in your samples and maybe I'll get to grow some too.
Yeah, totally.
Cool. All right, guys. Anyone have a question for us out there?
Yeah, I'm not seeing questions.
All right.
Anyway, yeah, you can post your questions and we'll try to.
What's up, New York Mushrooms?
Yeah.
All right. So, one thing I've noticed that you've been working on a lot is the reishi mushrooms. Do you want to touch on that at all? So, there's lots of different ways you can fruit them, different substrates, different species. We were talking before about the different species of Ganoderma. Do you want to cover any of that?
Some of it I'm learning, but reishi, the genus is Ganoderma, and there's several different species. They can be found all over the country. I've never found one in Colorado. Well, I guess that's not true. The artist conch is a Ganoderma that can be found in Colorado. But especially on the coasts or in wetter areas, it's kind of a red, very shiny mushroom on top and bright white on the bottom. It's a polypore. It's been in Chinese medicine for, you know, thousands of years. It's a very important mushroom in China, and it's said to have a lot of medicinal compounds, which that's something I'm learning about, and I'm trying to experience that. So that's why I'm growing reishi. I want to have a personal experience with fresh, high quality reishi and see if I notice anything in my body. I've heard that you might be able to sleep better, or it might affect your sleep, and so I'm wanting to experiment with that. So basically, I get a culture and grow it out on plates and expand the mycelium, and then what I've been doing recently is moving them to these no pasteurized bags, these instant shroom bags that I'm selling at Lion's Mane Shop down in Denver, in the Rhino District. So they have bags like this where all you have to do is add a few cups of water and let it absorb, and then add your clean spawn. So I've been doing it that way. So you don't have to, normally you would have to pressure cook it for an hour or so, and then let it cool, and then inoculate it in sterile conditions. But this way it eliminates a lot of that. There is still contamination risk. It's not gonna be 100%. But the last time I tried it, I did 18 bags, and I think maybe two of them got contaminated, so that's totally reasonable. But they've been doing really well in the bags, and I just, if you grab that bag.
Yeah.
I just kind of leave the bag inflated, and the reishi antlers will kind of grow up like fingers inside the bag, and I let them get as big as possible before I cut the bag open. And it's pretty easy to grow, and fun to watch. I mean, they're beautiful. It's art. But then I'm just recently kind of exploring, is this actually medicinal, and what does it do for me? Because I don't know that.
Cool. All right. Well, it looks like we got some questions coming in. So the first question was, what are the best trees for lion's mane in Colorado? So pretty much any hardwood, I would say.
Yeah. You know, so I've never found lion's mane. But I think I did see someone recently post on Mycology.
I found a Hericium americanum up in Telluride, okay. And that was on an aspen, so a birch tree.
Okay.
So I assume that Hericium will grow well on birch, probably cottonwoods, maple. It's really rare to find oak trees out here.
Yeah, we have scrub oak, but they're really small.
So any kind of hardwood.
You'd be really lucky if you found it, but they do exist.
Yeah. Lion's mane requires a lot of humidity, so you're going to look lower towards the ground, I think. Is that
maybe near like beaver ponds where there's humidity radiating?
So they're a little bit less rigorous than an oyster mushroom, and I feel like they're going to be a little harder to find, but look for your hardwoods.
Yeah.
All right. So the next question is Masters Mix Universal. So what are your thoughts on that? So my experience is shiitake might have some problems growing on it, but as far as, you know, all the species that I grow my mushrooms on, or all the species that I'm currently growing, Masters Mix has been, you know, pretty good performer. I've got this new Pleuratis dejamer. So this is the front runner, and this is growing on Masters Mix right now. So if you've been paying attention to my breeding project, I've got a pink oyster that I crossed, and it's fully colonized after 11 days on Masters Mix.
So we have Day Moonflower says she found lion's mane on oak. So that's reasonable. If that was in Colorado, great, good find. And then, let's see, Shroomery 713 asks, can moldy mushrooms make you sick? That is your specialty.
Yeah. So I actually did a talk about this. If you check out on YouTube, the Denver Mycological Society, I did a talk about mycotoxins. So there are specific types of mold that can produce mycotoxins, which are exudates from the mold. And those byproducts do not degrade in, you know, normal heating, like cooking. And if you, let's say Aspergillus niger, for instance, I would say that's
a black mold.
Yeah, that's a black mold. So Aspergillus niger is probably the most dangerous contaminant in mycology because of the aflatoxins that it produces. So these toxins can build up in your bloodstream or in your liver specifically, and it can cause chronic inflammation and even lead to, you know, some chronic liver conditions. So if you have any, you know, trichoderma molds or so trichoderma is a green mold. That can produce mycotoxins as well. It's not as harmful as Aspergillus niger, but it still is harmful. And with the popularity of using functional mushrooms, people are consuming small quantities over a long period of time. And if there's molds that are present that are producing aflatoxins, you'll be ingesting those in very small amounts over a long period of time. So it's very important to know where your mushrooms are coming from. My recommendation is, when in doubt, throw it out. So a proper, healthy mushroom cultivation will not have any mold present. And I think that that's the best practice.
Okay, great. So we have a question from MadMax303. He's asking about, can you collect spores from dried Cordyceps militaris? And then another question would be, is there an insight about growing single spore monocarion mycelium? So I'll take the first one, you take the second one.
All right.
So for Cordyceps, if you want, some of the experts on Cordyceps would be Ryan Paul Gates and William Padilla Brown. And those are the two most vocal on Facebook. So they are people that you want to follow. William Padilla Brown is going to do a class on genetics of Cordyceps and tracking the mating types of Cordyceps. I'm pretty sure that's what he's going to go on. He's going to do that this week, so it'd be good to follow him. But as far as Cordyceps goes, it's an ascomycete, which is different than the oysters or some of the other mushrooms that are being grown here. And so the spores develop differently, and they're in what's called an asci, and that grows on the, it forms on the surface of the Cordyceps. So if you look at it closely, it'll be kind of like a little bit hairy. So I haven't tried to, I'm going to try to isolate it from a dry Cordyceps, but the challenge would be that the spores might be trapped inside the asci. And so normally when you're trying to collect the spores, you would want to have a fresh specimen, so it's shooting them out of the ASCII onto auger or whatever. So that is general information about Cordyceps spore collection, but I'm not really an expert on that.
I would say in general, it's probably best to use fresh spores just because it's going to increase the viability.
Yeah.
And then what was the second part of that question?
The second one was like insight about growing monocarion single spore isolates.
All right.
You've been doing that.
Yeah. So if you have been following my breeding project, the way that I isolated my haploid mycelium so that I can combine two haploids to form a diploid mycelium, and that way you would be breeding specific phenotypes. So if you watch my video, basically I just do a serial dilution until you dilute out any potential contaminants so that in your solution you'll just have a quantifiable amount of spores, I guess viable spores, and then you would take a specific amount from that dilution and plate it out onto plates using a plate spreader, and that way you'll separate out single spores, and then you can grow out those single spore isolates, which will be a haploid isolate, so it would contain half the genetic material, and then you can introduce another haploid that would be isolated from the same plate or a different plate, and then combine them together, and they would form clamp connections, or they would just fuse together to form the diploid mycelium, which then you can grow out and produce fruits. So I've got an example of some of the mycelium just growing in a jar. This is a king oyster. So we have liquid cultures available on Etsy. But basically, if you're looking to hybridize strains or make your own cool strains, you're gonna have to isolate out single spores, which would be a haploid, and then you can do breeding that way. And it's pretty similar to cordyceps, right?
Yeah. So if you're another person, Sustainable Buddy mentioned Alex Dorr at Mushroom Revival. He's another wildly outspoken person about cordyceps melteris cultivation, and they have the largest farm for cordyceps in the U.S. So he's a really great resource as well. So cordyceps, if you're wanting to breed it, you would want to isolate single spores and check their mating types to make sure that they're compatible, just so you're not wasting time. You can do it without testing the genetics, but you need to have compatible mating types so that they can produce a fruiting mushroom. And that's really important if you're going to be serious about breeding.
Single spore mycelium. All right. Any other questions coming up?
Unless we missed some. Is it better to use bags or jars for spawn?
So bags versus jars for spawn. I would say there's pros and cons to both. Obviously, when you're using bags, you're just producing a lot more plastic waste because you can't use them over and over again. I prefer using jars, different size jars. There's pros and cons to those. I like to use these little half pint jars just because I can produce, you know, lots of different kinds of mushrooms in the same amount of space, where if I had one big jar, it would all be the same type of mushroom. But there's limitations to this too. I can't be, you know, inoculating huge bags with it. But bags, I feel like those are easier because you can break them up easier, and they're cheaper than jars. And you can sterilize a lot more grain when it's in bags, because jars are, you know, a solid structure, so when you're putting them in the pressure cooker, there's a lot of empty space, where if you use bags, you can get a lot more per run. But the drawback is that you're gonna have to sterilize longer because the thermo energy in the center of that pressure cooker is gonna, you know, be a lot more resistant if they're stuffed with bags compared to jars. So do you have anything else to add to that?
That question was LShay23. Good question. So bags versus jars, there's, as far as sustainability, there's some trade-offs. Like, you have to use a lot of water to wash jars. And the glass comes from a mined product. Sand is mined, and there's a lot of it's coming from China, and it's not being harvested sustainably. In a lot of places, it's being just dredged from rivers, so that has problems. And metal is mined as well. Not that mining is bad, but it can be done poorly. Plastic, we all know that there's problems with plastic. It's coming from an oil product, and then it doesn't degrade very well. So there's really two different kinds of bags. There's kind of your standard polypropylene bag, and then there's ones that are said to be more environmentally friendly.
We use these modified biodegradable bags. We get them from Meyer's Mushroom, but they're really kind of flimsy. That's the drawback. Mm-hmm. But I think they have additives that help it degrade faster than normal polypropylene.
I think it, from what I've heard, it breaks down because of UV, and it breaks down into smaller particles, which could be better, but also we have a problem with microplastics. So like every way that we go about anything has a problem. I mean, I don't know what's the most sustainable. Yep. Everything has a problem.
Yeah, I've grown in burlap bags before, and those are nice because they'll break down, but then at the same time, you know, mycelium will just eat out the bottom, so it makes it almost useless at that point. So
yeah, and there's like wild culture, but if you're going to try to be a farmer, trying to do that outside in Colorado, I mean, good luck.
Yeah.
That needs to be just kind of a secondary project, like where you're inoculating logs or stumps, which I'd like to get into doing, but it's not really a farming method exactly.
Yeah, I think the future might be in like hemp plastic or some kind of, you know, biodegradable plastic that you can compost and it would hold up in the pressure cooker. So if anyone's listening out there who can make that, that's going to be the winner.
Yeah.
All
right. Let's see. So, did you have something else on your list?
Mm.
Okay. Yeah, I have a couple of things. We talked about working on Reishi quite a bit. Another one that I'm excited about, I recently put out a time-lapse video of Hericium chloroloides that I got from Sydney Ober-Singleton, and he's in Washington. Just shipped me a culture, and just did it on the same cold pasteurizing bags. And it is really beautiful. It makes kind of a coral shape, and it's getting teeth growing on it. It's really firm. It also has a lot of these haricinones. So Hericium has multiple different species.
All right, check out our Hericium on Etsy. It's free shipping.
So this one's Erinaceus?
Yep.
So that's one of the species. Coroloides is another species, Americanum, and I'm sure there's many others.
Yep.
But they all have similar compounds that people are saying is neuroregenerative. And so I want to experiment with that. I'm trying to figure out, like, how can I grow a product and process a product to the point that I can notice that there's an improvement or even a harm. I just want to experience it for myself rather than trusting popular culture saying that it's good. So I want to try it out. And that's something I'm pretty excited about. I'm also messing with growing cordyceps for the same kind of reason. I have tried cordyceps and I do notice a energetic feeling to it. And so I want to see if that's a positive thing or a negative thing. Like, caffeine does not agree with me. And I'm wondering, you know, is it a beneficial thing? I've heard a lot of good things about cordyceps, but I want to experience it for myself. And I want it to be as fresh as possible. That's why I'm growing it myself rather than just purchasing it.
Yep. So someone asked about compost. So applications for mushroom compost. So my experience, I use it all the time in the garden. I mix it in with about 50-50 ratio of all my organic waste from the kitchen, and that makes a really nice compost. And then I'll use it in my raised beds. It holds in a lot of moisture, especially out in Colorado where, you know, it's dry all year. I found out that using the mycelium in the raised beds, it creates almost like this microclimate towards the center of the beds, and it's really nice for tomatoes and squash. And I know in the past you've buried entire blocks before, and then they'll fruit right in your garden. So that's another cool use. You can extend the life of your blocks just by burying them in the ground.
Yeah, and I kind of have a compost project at my house where we take all of our food waste that's not animal products, and we bury it in coffee grounds that we get at coffee shops. Like, we get maybe 5 gallons a week of coffee grounds, and that is, I found, a really good way to get compost going. If you're just trying to compost a small amount, you're gonna have a hard time unless you have some high-tech machinery. But if you're gonna really compost, then I think coffee grounds are an easy material, and you just pile it up, make a big mound, and then you can put your food scraps in it. And then you can also add your mushroom, spent mushroom blocks. And I think the word compost doesn't really refer to a spent block, because it's still quite a bit of wood chips. There is live mycelium in there, so if you break it up, it's going to probably get contaminated. But sometimes I've had oysters fruit out of my compost after it's really been thoroughly mixed and spread out in the garden, and oysters have come up through it. So mycelium is resilient.
Yep, that's pretty good. All right, so someone asked, advice for cold pasteurization recipes, techniques, for or against using lime. So I feel like he's a little more familiar with the cold pasteurization. You want to take that?
Yeah.
So we kind of ran that fruiting.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So this is actually on a block of my cold pasteurization product that's at Lion's Mane Shop downtown. And so it totally works. And you really just need to add water and seal the bag. So it's a great product.
Yeah.
But
I feel like there's weaknesses. Totally. So I've used Hericium strains that they kind of seem to fizzle out and not produce as rigorously. But you can see the oysters are doing great. Reishi does good. Yeah, so I feel like there can be... I feel like within a species, there could be different strains that would be more resistant to the alkaline of the lime. So you're going to have to really find a strain specific to that species if you want to grow Lion's Mane. That's just personal experience. What else do you think?
Yeah, so we kind of did a trial where he used his blend versus using hardwood fuel pellets like this. And it seems like the hardwood fuel pellets have a little more success with this particular method rather than using like fresh sawdust, it seems.
It might be the way that the pellets are produced.
Yeah, and then so the concept of cold pasteurization, there's probably two ways that you can go. One would be anaerobic digestion, and one would be by changing the pH. And so this method for these bags is we're just raising the pH. We're stealing hydrogen ions, and it makes it a little bit less pleasant for a lot of microbes. But a lot of mushroom mycelium actually really like it, and it reduces the competition. So you don't have to do the heat sterilization, but it does have its problems. And then one thing that I'm concerned about, which I haven't really researched very much, is where does lime come from? It's a product that's mined, and it's crushed, and it's cooked in a furnace. So we're using fossil fuels, and we're mining, which isn't bad. It's just that I don't want to pretend that this is good for the, if you're caring about the environment, you can't just pretend that just because we're not cooking on the stove that we're not having any fossil fuels, or that we're not hurting the environment because it's a natural product. So I haven't fully thought this through, but I'm a little skeptical that it might also have its problems.
Yep. Yeah. Cool. All right. So pros and cons to everything. All right. So the next question, the brewers using spent brewer's grain. So I have used distillery grains in the past with success. Shout out to Ironton Distillery in Denver. They used to give me these huge buckets of grain. One of the drawbacks with using spent grain is you have to use it right away within about 6 to 8 hours. Otherwise, it'll start to colonize with yeast and other bacteria. And if you wait, at least when I would get it at room temperature, so then I would bring it home and then jar it up and run my grain spawn with no issues. But if you wait at least, you know, overnight, then all of those batches were no good. So if you can find a way that you can sync up your grow with, you know, the day that they're brewing, I feel like it's doable, but it's a very time sensitive way to grow mushrooms. So I don't know, you have any input on that?
I've never used it. Yep. But, you know, the great thing is, one problem that we have in this world is that we make a product without considering what the waste turns into. And so if we as mushroom cultivators have the opportunity to use nature's recycler and take waste products, whether it's the spent grains or sawdust that's a waste product, or
even cardboard,
paper.
Yep, a lot of agaricus could use cardboard for spawn.
Yeah,
so
and logs.
Yep. Like
if someone gets a tree removed that isn't totally sick, you can, instead of taking that to the dump, you can inoculate it with oyster, shiitake, whatever, depending on the species of tree. So we have the opportunity of using a waste product, and it becomes a commodity.
All right. So,
pellets, sawdust, or chips for growing lion's mane. I think we're both using sawdust.
Yep, sawdust. But I've used everything with success. I feel like wood chips might be the hardest. Definitely want to mix in, you know, some of the smaller particulates if you're using wood chips, just because the lion's mane mycelium is very thin and spindly, and if you have big, thick chunks in your bags, as soon as you go to move that bag, it's going to damage the mycelium. Whereas if you have sawdust or pellets, it's going to create like a nice firm pocket, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, and so if you're referring to chips, like chips are often used for outdoor beds. Like you can do oysters and lots of mushrooms outdoors on chips, but lion's mane, you wouldn't do that because it really needs to be fruiting horizontally. You wouldn't have it coming up out of your garden bed. And if it did, it would be really full of sticks and dirt, and you wouldn't want to eat it anyway. So then how do you get chips? One option is there's an app, I think it's called Chip Source, or there's an app that you can use to locate local arborists, and they'll just dump the chips in your yard. Sometimes they're mixed. You don't have a lot of control on what it is, and you get a huge amount of chips. But that's a great way to get a local waste product. You can buy them in the barbecue section. There's a lot of hardwood chips available, maple, oak, that you can buy at Ace Hardware or in some of the hardware stores in the barbecue section.
All right. Good machine for making sawdust. So there's various types of sawdust. My favorite sawdust comes from a CNC machine. So there's a product out there called the Wood Whiz, which it's a CNC machine used for, you know, designing really precise cuts in wood. And then it has a vacuum that's attached to it. So as soon as it cuts the wood, it'll take that sawdust and collect it all. There's a finer sawdust that you can get from like a sander that's gonna do like the final planing. That's a little bit too fine, but it will work if you mix it in with other, you know, size particles. And then you can get planer sawdust, so that's made from a blade that cuts the plane of the wood, and that's gonna create like little curls in it. That's another type of sawdust that I use. I like to blend them all together so that you get different size particles all in the same bag, and that way you'll get the really fine ones that the mycelium can jump onto, and then thicker particles for, you know, little storage nutrient storage bins essentially for the mycelium. You have any thoughts on that?
I think that's good. Pick a blend.
Yep.
So then New York Mushrooms says people mix their mycelium into their bags. Is that damaging them? So yes, when you break apart the mycelium, the threads are being ripped and torn and cut. The interesting thing about mycelium, the mushroom creature, it's what's called holographic. So one cell is able to reproduce the entire organism. That's not exactly true about people, but we have the genetics for our entire body in every cell. But if you take a piece of skin, you can't grow a new human without incredible science. But mycelium, you really can take one cell and reproduce the whole creature. So what you're doing when you break up the mycelium is you're creating multiple points of inoculation so that that new substrate can colonize quickly before other organisms get to it. So you are damaging it, and you'll notice this. If you shake up your mycelium jar on grains, and then you're gonna, it's gonna, the whiteness is gonna kind of go away immediately. Yeah. That's from bruising. So you can break that.
This one's pretty resilient.
The whiteness is kind of going away. You're bruising the mycelium. But what you want to do is separate each grain if possible so that each one is a new inoculation point. So when you mix this into your sawdust bag, you're going to notice it's not going to do anything for a couple of days, sometimes longer depending on your species. And so it's trying to recover, it's trying to repair those broken tissues, and then it will jump. There's a liquid culture
question. Yep. All right. So does this impact the fruiting? So we'll go back to, so I think that if I have, so this is a bag that is almost ready to be fruited. If I shook this up out and then tried to fruit it, it wouldn't really produce anything. So I feel like you have to wait until the mycelium is very firm. It makes like a solid network and then you would fruit it.
Yeah.
But as far as shaking up the grain, I don't think it affects fruiting at all, because then you'd use this to inoculate the...
Yeah, you want to do it as little as possible. So
yep.
A standard would be at 30% colonization, you can shake it up and spin it. But you probably don't want to do it more than once during colonization and then once at the inoculation.
Cool. All right, so tried and true liquid culture, who did that?
Mrs. Tree 21.
All right, Mrs. Tree 21. So I personally like to use honey water, just 4% honey water. It works for all my liquid culture strains. Got some new ones on Etsy if you check them out. But honey water solution seems to work fine. It's a little bit more susceptible to bacteria than something like TSB or any broth that you buy, like laboratory grade broth. You can buy that, and you can also get antibiotics in it. So it really depends on your application, but for my production I only use local sourced honey and water, and you know, it costs very little. A whole jar of honey will last me the whole year. Do you have any thoughts on liquid culture?
I have done honey water mostly, and I think I did something with malt extract, but there's probably thousands of recipes. If you're not getting the results that you're looking for, you could try a different recipe. Mm-hmm. But you're probably going to have bigger problems with your sterile technique and with your sterilization. Those are probably going to be bigger issues than what the actual recipe is.
Yep. One of the problems though with honey liquid cultures is you don't want to burn it, so don't overcook it. That's with, you know, a lot of liquid cultures.
Yeah, same with malt. You know.
Yeah.
Don't overcook it. So yeah. Depends on the size.
20 to 30 minutes.
But if you're doing a huge batch, it might take longer.
Yep. Cool. All right. Any other questions?
I think we got all your questions. If we missed one, just re-put it back in there. I guess another thing, a couple other projects I'm working on. If you're in the Denver area, well, really anywhere, I'm trying to put together like a guerrilla mycology project of taking wild strains and reintroducing them into stumps on purpose. Like maybe the city came and cut trees down, or your neighbor cut down a tree and purposely inoculating those with, you know, probably oysters, but finding a local strain and inoculating it so that you have a little honeypot in the future, and also, you know, degrading that wood. So if you're interested in that, let me know.
How long do you keep on the stir plates? So for me, I use my stir plates for a couple different reasons. So one of the reasons is to really stimulate growth. So if that's the case and I just inoculated my liquid cultures, I'll stir them on the stir plate for about 4 or 5 hours and then put it in my incubator. And then the next day, maybe do it again. And that way it's breaking up the mycelium into tiny little particles. And then those will all grow and kind of fuse with each other. So I would say about 4 or 5 hours on the stir plate and then 2 or 3 days incubating. But another reason that I use the stir plate is when I'm making my liquid cultures. So I'll take the stir plate and then turn it on for, you know, 20 or 30 minutes to really break up that mycelium. So when I make my syringes, it'll be much more homogeneous and it'll be a thicker syringe so that when I'm inoculating, I only have to use a little bit. And then a third reason I would use my stir plate is when I'm doing my quality control, it mixes up the solution. So if there's any contaminants, it's going to separate those and then it will give you a much more homogeneous solution. And that would only take, you know, 2 or 3 minutes of mixing and all the bacteria would, you know, come up from the bottom or wherever it's at. And then you'll get a really solid view when you're doing your quality control.
Yeah. So one of the main reasons that you'd use a stir plate is you're trying to incorporate oxygen into the water.
Yeah.
So that's really the reason. And I think you can probably figure it out on your own what you like doing. I've left jars mixing for days and it's totally fine. And I've also left jars sitting without stirring for days or weeks. And it's interesting because it'll grow like a layer of mycelium on the surface. So it's like behaving differently and you may want to use that to manipulate what you're doing.
Cool. Oyster. Sweet.
Right. Yeah, an oyster in the San Luis Valley. That's pretty cool.
Good work.
Yeah. I think that's all the questions for now.
Yeah. Can one-time syringes be reused?
Yeah, usually. So you can re-pressure cook them. So you'd want to, if you're planning on reusing one, make sure that it's clean before you put it away because you don't want mycelium drying up inside the needle. That'd be really hard to clean out. The next thing that you would do is probably make a little foil taco packet. So you'd fold it up in there and then fold all the edges and you would pressure cook that. Most syringes, syringes like the liquid culture ones, you can pressure cook them and they'll come out just fine and reuse them.
So how long do I keep my LC masters? So I personally, all of my master cultures are on slants. And those can keep for many, many months. And then when I'm about to make my liquid culture, I'll pull from the slant and then grow it out, QC it. And then as long as my QC...
For your cultures, although that's kind of like reintroducing genetic combinations. So you're not going to have a clone, but you'll have the same genetic line from spores. So there's a question about wood chips. I think you probably would think of maybe sawdust, like a small particle. So a lot of people add the final substrate to their auger plates or even to liquid culture to try to introduce the mycelium to a food source, because what the mycelium does is it has a genetic code and it's running these programs that make proteins, and those proteins can break down other chemicals. So they release those out into the wilderness and those chemicals go around and they're little machines that can cut or build outside of its body. And so there are receptors that it's able to recognize whether those things work or don't. And it gets some feedback. So when it encounters things like sawdust, where there's lignin and cellulose, which are difficult for a lot of organisms to break down, it's able to recognize the food source around it. And it might, some people would say learn, or at least alter its behavior based on its surroundings. And so some people think that that is a great way to train mycelium to eat new food sources or to prepare it for its final substrate so that it's ready. And I think there's a lot of validity in that, but the language is kind of anthropomorphizing, excuse me. Anyway, trying to add human attributes to mycelium, which might not be appropriate, or it might be totally appropriate.
All right. LC temperature storage. So I store my liquid cultures at 34 degrees. That will slow down the growth, but you can store them at room temperature and they'll just keep growing. But yeah, I do 34 to 37. That's a long-term storage for liquid culture for me. What are your thoughts on that?
I haven't really done anything too crazy, just room temperature or refrigerator. So refrigerator, I don't have a thermometer in there, but it's probably in the 40s or upper 30s. So that's good to slow the metabolization down. But as far as, I just kind of been going with room temperature. I'm starting to experiment with changing the room temperature based on species. So yeah, I'm basically a hobbyist, and I'm producing mushrooms for myself and for learning about them. It's
always fun to push the extremes.
Yeah.
That's what I would say.
Yeah. So I'm just trying to learn about mushrooms and experience. Like, I mean, I kind of feel like you can build a sort of friendship, or at least a knowledge of a relationship with some of the mushrooms. And so I'm just kind of exploring different species, and I'm going to start messing with temperatures.
Cool. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's also important with cordyceps. Like, you can't let it get maybe above 70 degrees. So you need to keep the temperatures low for that. So that's kind of what's spurring me on to address the room temperatures.
Cool. Well, I think we're maybe going to wrap it up here soon.
Okay. Yeah. So last thing is, I am not ready to launch yet, but I'm working on an online class. So the in-person classes have been really hands-on and personalized instruction, having all the tools available for a home lab so that you're actually getting real life experience. It's totally not a lecture. There's some lecture, and I'm working on the concept of moving that online and trying to hang on to those, my favorite parts of the class. So I am working on that, working on manufacturing tools and the whole kit, working on like the video production to make sure that it's actually worth watching. And then I really want to maintain the one-on-one coaching aspect of it. So I'm working on that. And
yeah, check out our YouTube videos.
Yeah, YouTube videos.
Yeah, so Mushroom Cult on YouTube. It's got some really good content. I'm going to be, or I just restocked my liquid cultures. So again, I got some really cool beach mushrooms. I'm going to be doing a video soon on top fruiting. It's kind of my new favorite thing is top fruiting all these different kinds of mushrooms. So we've got the brown beach, chestnuts, piapino. And then we've got king oyster. These are our piapino. So you can see how big they get when they're top fruiting. So I'll be doing a video on this, but check out our liquid cultures, and then check out our websites too, Fresh from the Farm Fungi and mushroomcult.net. We'll be posting this up on YouTube soon, and hopefully we'll get to do some more of these videos. But yeah, some online courses in the pipeline and one-on-one. If you ever feel the need to ask a question, reach out to either of us and we should get back to you soon. So thanks guys
for tuning in.
Yeah. And we'll try to do some more of these videos in the future. All right, much love.
Thanks.